Next. I'll give you a second, Mr. Spears, if you need.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm going to take just a moment to regroup, and I'm going to call Ann Herrera.
All right.
Could you ask Mrs. Herrera? She's outside.
Ann Herrera, attorney. Do you need water?
Ann Herrera?
Make sure your chair is up a little
yes.
bit.
Yes, I'm falling over backwards.
Okay. Ms. Herrera is pledged, that's what we're worried about. So you keep pulling it in, she's getting closer to the ledge.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. Come this way.
Okay. Ms. Herrera, are you a member of the State Bar?
Yes, I am.
How long have you been practicing?
I passed the bar in 1983.
Have you been practicing consecutively?
Yes, I have.
What is your field of practice?
I do fiduciary law.
And in the course of that, are you also serving as county administrator?
Yes, I am, for Fulton County.
And you used to serve for the county administrator?
Yes, I did.
Are you a member of any section of the bar?
Fiduciary section of the bar, yes.
And you routinely attend the Fiduciary Law Institute, is that so?
Yes, I do.
As county administrator, do you have time? Do you actually serve as chief administrator or administrator of will and assets, that's right?
Yes, I do.
And during, in the course of that, do you have to hire attorneys from time to time?
Yes, I do.
And I'm going to ask you some questions about fees. My hourly rate is $3.25. Do you have an opinion based on your experience with hiring attorneys to do their own fiduciary cases as to whether that is a reasonable and normal hourly rate?
I would say it's very reasonable. In fact, I think it's a little lower than what I see very often.
You should tell me that. I'm going to ask you to testify on my behalf in this case, and I'd like to ask you what you have done to prepare for this testimony.
What I did was first, you and I had a conversation. I came to your office. You had a number of volumes of pleadings. I believe there were three for each one of the estates. It was a husband and wife estate. And I went through those on my own. And I made a list of all the pleadings and all the different file folders that I would like to have copies of to take back to my office and review on my own. Someone from your office or you made those copies at my request, brought them to my office. And then I spent a fair amount of time going through all the Fulton County dockets, your own docket of your pleadings, correspondence, copies of emails. I've gone through Mr. Hamburg's billings, I've gone through your billings, and I've spent a number of hours.
Okay, you said that you had reviewed the dockets for the Fulton County, for this case?
Yes.
I
Can you do it, Mr. Barrett? It's our court docket on both the states.
These are the court documents for both cases, because Ms. Herrera referred to us. And if not, give you all copies in just a second.
What are the numbers again?
28 is the Federico Alvarez estate, and 29 is the Graciela Alvarez estate.
Yes, I do.
And do you keep those in your custody? Do you keep them just like if you were representing a client in the case?
Yes, I do.
And do you use those records as the basis for petitioning for extra compensation if you decide to do that?
Yes, I do. I file a number of petitions to get the court to determine issues like competing claims. Generally, they're in the form of a petition for final settlement of accounts. At the time that I've marshaled everything into the estate, we've paid all the debts that are not disputed, and there are reimbursement and claims brought by parties that have to, that continue to be disputed.
And is it fair to say that your protection as an administrator, is the court order, unless it's what you ask the court to do?
Always, yes.
You've had a chance to review my time records in this case.
Yes, I have.
I want to ask you a couple of, bar rule 1.5 questions with respect to fees. And these are really going to the question, were these fees reasonable? So I can start with that. Do you feel that $325 an hour is a reasonable fee to the title board?
Yes, it is.
In this case?
Yes, it is.
Do you have an opinion as to whether the work that was done in this case was necessary?
I believe it was, yes.
Okay. One of the questions about these, you said as an administrator, you hire attorneys to represent you.
Yes, I do.
And as a private attorney, you also handle private cases on your own.
Yes, I do.
So you're familiar with attorney billing records?
Yes.
I'm going to ask you this. Do you think $325 is a fee, an hour that is not customarily charged in this area for similar work?
It is well within the range. And as I believe I testified, it's probably mid-range. There are many attorneys out there who do fiduciary law, who are very experienced, who charge substantially more per hour.
What do you think is the amount of time and labor involved and the skill necessary to deal with a case like the one? I'm asking specifically about the Alvarez.
Well, I looked at one of the reasons I wanted to look at the dockets as well as Mr. Hamburg's own billing records was I wanted to make a determination as to reasonableness when you got in the case. At what point were you retained by Mr. Hamburg to help him, assist him with legal aspects of this case? And I thought it was very interesting to find out that Mr. Hamburg had put in almost half of his hours by the time he got to the point, it appears, to almost want to resign because things had gotten so difficult and they were moving on to a new legal level of opposition and filings and caveats and objections. So it seemed very appropriate for Mr. Hamburg to retain you at the time he did. But so much of the administrative work, so much of the groundwork that you do any time you take on an estate had been done. But it appeared from the pleadings and emails and so on that I saw once you got involved, it was for a specific series of things that looked like they were going to be happening going forward. This estate wasn't moving in the direction that it needed to move in order to be finalized, pay final claims, make distributions, shut it down. So that to me supports to a very large extent the reasonableness of number one, you being retained to help Mr. Hamburg, and also the reasonableness of what you needed to do going forward in terms of aggressive pleadings, but also responding to all the different pleadings that were coming in, all the responses. And I made a list and categorized all these pleadings and responses, and it appears that all the actions were very reasonable at that time.
You said you looked at my will and records and Mr. Hamburg's. Did you find instances where we both did something on the same day that we did not, or we didn't both charge for?
No, I didn't find that there was overlap in billing, and I did specifically look for that. There were a lot of issues, as I said, that Mr. Hamburg had already resolved that you were not involved in at all. I think specifically, so much of Mr. Hamburg's initial time on this case was surrounding the house and getting that house because it was the primary asset, so I understand from all the pleadings. And that sale had gone through, I believe, by the time you were retained. So you were dealing with some very new and different issues that were coming up. So I didn't see that overlap, which I've seen before where there's an overlap of duplicity of efforts, but I did not see that in any of the buildings.
And you're aware, just for the record, that Mr. Hamburg filed his own petition for a final settlement and his own petition for extra comp, and I did not represent him in those matters.
Correct.
Okay, one of the issues here in the rule is the likelihood that the acceptance of particular employment will preclude other employment by the lawyer. You see that here in this case?
I think that I don't really understand that rule. Is when you take one case, obviously that takes away your time and energy to do other cases. So in that respect, every time we take on another case, it eliminates the time we can work on something else.
Have you ever been wrong about how much time you thought a case would take?
Every day.
One of the other factors is the amount involved in the results obtained. Now, the amount involved in this case was $360,000. How do you feel about the results that were obtained with respect to the amount that was involved here?
Well, at first glance, I think anyone would say if you have an estate, in my experience, with $360,000 or $350,000, if someone were to pay professional fees for administrator and fees for an attorney that were a big chunk of that estate, that should take one should take a second look at that. And of course you do, because people say, oh, that's a lot of money. And it is a lot of money. On the other hand, when you look at all the work that was done, when you look at all the notebooks, you look at the fact that this was two estates, yes, they have overlapping, they're very similar estates, but you're still looking at an administrator having potential liability for two estates. So the legal work, the administrative work is benefiting two estates, but it's really one hourly rate that you are charging for both estates. I mean, we're dividing this, I believe your petition asks for it to be 50-50. So you really, I think that because of the litigiousness of this entire two estates and having to respond and it being expanded, and every step of the way it seemed to get response after response after objection, it's unfortunate, but I think that the results that were obtained, which is that it's now ready to be closed, I think all the work was probably was necessary in order to get there.
So do you think, in your opinion, based on your review of the records and the documents, are the fees that I've charged, proposed to charge here, reasonable and necessary in this case?
Yes.
Thank you. Any more questions?
Thank you. Any questions?
No questions.
All right. Do you have any questions? You can step down. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to excuse her if you...
Yes, Your Honor. Thank you.
All right. Excuse. You're free to go.
That didn't fall off, so.
Maybe not yet.
It's coming.
Maybe we have to submit it, Your Honor?
Yes.